In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Join me in prayer. On my heart imprint your image, blessed Jesus, King of grace, that life's riches, cares, and pleasures never may your work erase. Let the clear inscription be, Jesus crucified for me, is my life, my hope's foundation, and my glory and salvation. Amen. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. One of the most famous theologians of the 20th century is C.S. Lewis. Lewis grew up an atheist and was brought to the faith, obviously by the Holy Spirit, working through some of his close friends, talking with him about the differences between atheism and Christianity. Lewis, upon becoming a Christian, being baptized, chosen as one of the elect of Christ, went from being a militant atheist to one of the strongest defenders of the Christian faith in the history of the church. He would write so many books that no one could argue against, like Mere Christianity or The Great Divorce. He wrote his Narnia books and one of his more famous ones, The Screwtape Letters. You could argue that Lewis was one of the most feared defenders of the faith. No one who would question the faith desired to debate with Lewis, a staunch, strong defender of Christ. But one of his best books, though, or in my opinion now, my favorite book that he's written, that I just read, is called A Grief Observed. Lewis wrote this book after the death of his wife. She died of cancer. And he wrote this book as a journal of what he was feeling in his time of grief. And remember now, Lewis is a champion of the faith, would defend the mercy, love, and compassion of Christ to the whole world. And this is what Lewis said it felt like when his wife died, how he felt toward God. He said, when you are happy, so happy that you have no sense of needing Him, so happy that you are tempted to feel His claims upon you as an interruption, if you remember yourself and turn to Him with gratitude and praise, you will be, or so it feels, welcomed with open arms. But go to Him when your need is desperate, when all other help is vain. And what do you find? A door slammed in your face and the sound of bolting and double bolting on the inside. So Lewis, this champion of the faith, in the death of his wife, feels that God has forsaken him, has abandoned him, does not love him. I would imagine that the widow of Nain felt this way. For her husband has already died, and now her only son died. She is forsaken by God, alone, confused, numb. That's what death does to us. It kills us, forsakes us, it traumatizes us, both mind and body. The widow lost everything, husband and son. I can't even begin to imagine the pain that this woman felt. I can't sit here and say, I know what you're going through. I don't. I have my wife. I've not lost any of my children. I have no earthly idea the pain that this woman is going through. It is real pain. Something that no alcohol, no drug, no earthly lust can get rid of or overcome. she is completely alone. Even though she has everyone surrounding her in the funeral procession, she is by herself in her grief and in her despair. Have you ever felt the widow's grief? Have you ever been inconsolable? Have your emotions been so chaotic, so messed up that one second you're laughing and crying the next, and you have no clue how to get balanced again? Now, you know the answers, right? You who come to church know the answers for your loved ones who die in the faith. We know that those who die, they don't die but live. They rest for a moment, anticipating the resurrection of all the flesh. They live eternally in Christ. And we know this, for that is what Scripture declares to us. But does that make the grief any easier? Does that make the loss of mother, father, husband, wife, child, friend, anyone who is dear to you, does that make that easier? Does it make the grief go away? Does it make it easier to get up in the morning? Does it numb the pain of losing someone who meant the world to you, who enjoyed the lovely cruise of life with you? No. Grief is heavy, dark, depressing, and painful. Be it grief in death or grief and sadness in anything else in this life, it is like a knife being stabbed in your belly. You're going to feel it. And you'll always have a scar to remind you of it. Well, peace be with you, you who grieve. May the devil be cast out of your life and the world be silenced in order that you can hear the words of your compassionate Savior, Jesus the Christ. For what did Jesus say to the grieving widow? Did he come up to her and pat her on the back and say, "There, there, he's in a better place"? Did he talk about how much God loves her and loved her son? Did he make a casserole for her and just sit with her, making sure she was never alone, a theology of presence, if you have it, to keep her company in her grief? No, that would have been the kind thing to do. That's what you and I do when someone has lost a loved one or someone has had a traumatic experience. We comfort them just by being there with them. But what does Jesus say to the weeping widow? He says, "Stop your crying." We make it really nice sounding in our translation. "Weep not. Do not weep." That's not what he says. He says, "Stop your crying." Can you imagine saying this to someone who's at their funeral and just crying their eyes out? Or if someone said it to you when you were mourning the loss of a loved one, if they came up and said, "Stop your crying"? Well, of course you'd never say that to someone. And I hope that no one would ever say it to you. If it's so rude, though, if it's so crass, why then does Jesus say this to this widow? Because Jesus isn't saying, "Stop crying because it's annoying. Stop crying because there's nothing to cry about." That's not what he's saying. His words aren't a suggestion or a request. His words are an imperative, a command. When he says, "Weep not," Jesus is not offering advice, but actually stopping her tears by his word. When Jesus speaks, his words accomplish what they say. When we tell people to stop crying, like when I tell my sons to stop crying, it just makes them cry even more. But when Jesus says stop crying, the tears come to an end. They stop and the eyes are dried up. And how do they stop? How does Jesus dry the eyes of the weeping widow? He dries them up by taking them on himself, by taking her grief, her pain-ridden grief, and makes it his own. And then he goes up to the boy, as it says, he went up and touched the bier, made himself unclean by touching the dead body, and the bearer stood still. And he said, young man, I say to you, arise. Jesus spoke, and the boy arose. One who was once dead is now alive. One who was once grieving is now joyous. For as Luther recalled, the widow's son is dead, with all senses and hearing stopped. But as soon as Christ speaks to him, he hears. This is certainly an unusual, astonishing story. The one who does not hear, hears. The one who does not live, lives. And yet Christ does nothing more than open his mouth and tell him to arise. That one word is so powerful that death must yield and life again returns. Just as Christ spoke and took the widow's grief and her son's death and exchanged them for his joy and his life, so does he do the same for you who grieve this day. For Christ dried up the widow's eyes by taking her grief and putting it to death on the cross. There on the cursed tree did Jesus take the widow's grief and die, in order that her son may have not just temporal life, but eternal life. By his death, he destroyed death, and by his stripes, the widow's grief and our grief is taken away and healed. God in Christ has and will always visit his people, so that our grief is replaced with gladness, death exchanged for life. Hear then today, you who grieve and weep, just as Christ spoke and took the widow's grief and made it his own and granted her joy in the life of her son, so does he take your grief this day, your doubt, your abandonment, your anxiety, your depression. He takes all of it. He doesn't leave any sin left over. He takes it all, bears it in himself, stretches out his arms and cries out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Confesses our unbelief, confesses our grief, confesses our doubt and anxiety, and allows himself to be forsaken, rejected, in order that you and I are accepted. Christ has and will always take your grief and make it his own, so that you are given his joy, his righteousness, his life as an eternal child, both of his Father and your Father. Jesus is given to you this day, and he says to you, arise, you are forgiven. I love you unconditionally. Jesus spills out his guts for you today. Your grief is his joy is yours. Your death is his life is yours. So hear then the gospel promise, you the beloved. Hear then the proclamation of the eternal love of Christ, you who walk through this valley of the shadow of death. Hear the words, according to the revelation to Saint John, that say, for the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Jesus visits you, his beloved, today at this altar, where your grief is his life is yours. Rejoice then, you who weep, for Jesus doesn't shut the door, even though that's how Lewis felt, even though that may be how you feel in your time of grief. Jesus doesn't shut the door and bolt it up. No, he busts through that door. He annihilates that door that separates you from God. And he comes and he doesn't chastise you, but he says, "Peace be with you. You are loved. Even though you don't feel it, you are loved. Even though you question it, you are forgiven. The door is unlocked and opened wide so that you may enter in with all the elect who have gone before you. For you are baptized into Christ, a child of paradise. Christ, your crucified and resurrected Savior, speaks today, 'Weep not,' he says, 'for I have risen. And so shall you, to dwell forever with me and all the saints, all the host, arrayed in white forever. Weep not, your eyes are dried up. Christ shall come again soon to take us all home to be with him.'" Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia, amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.